Grace Point Church, we are so glad you're here this morning as we've come together to worship our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Now, you may notice it's a little warmer in here today. Now, it's not, I just want you to know, it's not the conviction of the Holy Spirit, it's the air conditioning's out right now, right? So let's begin our worship right now by standing together and lifting up our voices in songs of praise and celebration.
Spoken to me.
Amen. You may be seated, and the children are dismissed for Children's Church. If they would see Mr. Tim right back in the corner.
Good morning, Grace Point. Good morning. I hope one day to be so reliant on God that I can say without him I'm lost. I don't know if I'm always at that spot. I know without a GPS I'm lost. I am like directionally challenged, so I never know where I'm at. Without a GPS, for sure I'm lost. Without God, for sure we are lost as well. It's a good morning because we have Dr. John Walton is in the house. Yes! And I'll introduce him in just a minute. But I just want to give a few announcements before we open up God's Word together. And the first is this. Next week, this next upcoming Sunday, we are going to be outside in the park. Woohoo! We're going to do this 3 times this summer. So we tried it last year and we really enjoyed it. We're going to do it on the first week of July, first week of August, first week of September. We'll be at different places. Next week, we're going to be at Adler Park in Libertyville. That's where we were last week. We're going to have a bunch of food and we're going to have brats this time. You got to have some brats. Come on. And we're going to have a service, and we've got these little cards in your bulletin. That is so you can give this away to a friend, and you can have them come. And I just got this big old yard. Have you played Connect Four? Any of you played Connect Four? I got a big yard version of that. It's huge. It's almost as big as me. We're going to play that, and we'll have lots of games and a service and just some time to hang out. So that's going to be this upcoming Sunday. Notice it's at 10 a.m. and not 9:30. We're going to give ourselves a little bit more time in the morning to get ready for that. So hope you can make it. Also, a few other things that are happening in July. July 24th, which is in like 4 weeks. We're hoping to do a membership class after the service. A few of you are asking about membership, as well as having a baptism service on July 24th. So I know some of you are thinking about baptism. Let's get that nailed down, and because we're going to dunk some people on the 24th, which is almost, I don't know if that's like a year anniversary of yours, Jay. I don't know. I'll have to look at what date you were. It was almost like, we'll celebrate a year anniversary of Jay's baptism, and we'll do some more, and then we'll have membership on the 24th. And then the 31st, the last week of July, we're going to do our church chats, which is just where we have a time after service. The leadership, the elders, we're going to just share what God is doing. We're going to think a lot about some outreach opportunities and how God is leading us there. And then we are going to have a potluck after that. So don't bring any food for our outdoor service. We'll provide all that. But at the end of the month in July, we'll be able to bring a side to pass, and then we're just going to be able to eat together. So lots of things happening in July. We turned our air conditioning off so you can just prepare to be outside next week. All right. So, we're going to deal with that today. But thanks for your patience and your grace. All right, let's look into God's word. We have Dr. Walton is here, and I'm so thankful that he's here. It's going to be a perfect time because we've been walking through the entire Old Testament. We just finished with Nehemiah, I think it was, last week. And I was asking you guys to give me your summaries. How would you summarize the Old Testament in a line or a phrase? I've been getting some messages, some texts. I just got a few texts this morning. Charlene, I saw yours. Wonderful summaries just of what the Old Testament is all about. And John Walton has spent a lot of his life in the Old Testament. He's traveled to the ancient Near East. And every time I get into one of his books, I'm seeing things that I've never seen before. And he's a wonderful reader of scripture. Really, really expert in helping us figure out how did the original hearers hear these words? And what did it originally mean to them? And then therefore, how can we properly interpret these passages? So he's spent, I don't know how many years doing that. You were at Moody, right, for a while? You were at Moody, and now he's at Wheaton. And he loves the local church and is just invested in teaching God's people. So he's a trusted voice, and he's come here to just share with us what he sees as a major theme throughout all of Scripture. So let me just pray for us as we prepare our hearts to hear God's word. Dear God, we thank you so much for this time, all that you're doing in our nation, all that you're doing in our world, God, all that you're doing in our personal lives. God, we do admit that without you, we are lost, and we want to remember that today, because sometimes we're self-sufficient. Sometimes we think we can figure things out on our own, and yet that's not the truth of your word. And so, God, I pray that you would be with us now, God. I pray that your spirit would be over and in and among and through and above and in front of us so that we could hear your word, that I pray that our eyes would be opened, God, that you would soften our hearts, God, that you would show us things that we haven't quite seen before, God, that we could make connections, God, that we would fall more in love with you because of your word and because of the preaching of your word and because of what John has prepared for us today. God, we thank you for him being here, and God, I pray that you would work powerfully through him to us. God, in all these things, we pray you would give us eyes to see and ears to hear. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Would you welcome up John Walton for me, with me?
Thanks, Mike. Good morning. It's so nice to be here with you. And we'll see if we can warm up the room. Or am I supposed to say a breath of fresh air. Anyway, what is the Bible all about? Wow, you've been talking about that. And I want to talk about it today and maybe add some ideas to what you've been learning as you've been marching through the Old Testament. What is the Bible all about? Let me frame the question a different way. Why did God create us? What's going on? God certainly doesn't need us. What has God always wanted? Big questions. And we're going to take a relatively short run from Genesis to Revelation to try to suggest some answers, or at least some ways to think about those things. I call this Immanuel theology. And you'll understand that a little bit more as we go along in our quest this morning. So let's start in Genesis 1, why don't we? Genesis 1 has these days of creation. And sometimes people talk about the 6 days of creation. But that only shows that they've failed to grasp the significance of day 7. In fact, we often don't know what to do with day 7. God rested. Huh? Like, what's up with that? God doesn't get tired. He doesn't need downtime. What's this God rested thing? And we just hear that and we say, oh, well, I guess it's just like a Jewish holiday or something. And we write it off and then look to the 6 days to tell us what creation is all about. Big mistake. The 7th day is the most important day. The 7th day is what it's all about. But in our misunderstanding of it, we miss something important. See, what happens is we think like Americans instead of thinking like Israelites. It's easy to do. It's kind of who we are. But for some of the things in the Bible, we need to try to put on a different set of glasses to start thinking in terms of how they thought. As Pastor Mike mentioned, that's sort of an area that's my specialty. When you look in the ancient world, you find that when they talk about a God resting, they're not talking about the God relaxing or having leisure time, taking a nap. When they talk about a God resting, that's something that the God does in the temple. And when God rests, he doesn't rest on a bed, on a recliner, on a futon, in a hammock. When God rests, here it is, he rests on a throne. Huh. Okay, that's big. That's different. God rests on a throne. God's rest is God's rule. And he can rest on his throne because he has brought about stability and order. And so God brings order to the cosmos, Genesis 1. And then he sits down on his throne to rule that which he has created. Take a look at Psalm 132. This, he's talking about the temple. This is my resting place. See? It's even in the Bible. God rests in a temple. This is my resting place forever and ever. Here I will sit. Whoa. Sit. Here I will sit enthroned. For I have desired it. You know, it's not often in the Bible that we have an explicit statement about something God desires. Does he just like a fancy chair? What does he mean, I've desired it? The temple was the palace of the gods in the ancient world and in Israel as well. It wasn't a place where people gathered like we are today to worship corporately. It was a place of God's dwelling. And the temple was that place. And God was enthroned there, ruling the world. And he desired it because he desired to be with us. He desired to be living among the people that he created. He desired to be in relationship with us. Now you've heard my two key words for the morning: presence and relationship. That's at the core of the Emmanuel theology. In the ancient world, they believed that the gods had created people because the gods were tired of working. Of course, this is not Israel's way of thinking. We'll get to that in a moment. But the Babylonians or the Egyptians or the Hittites or the Canaanites all believed that people had been created because the gods had kind of been going along, living by themselves and for themselves, but the gods had needs. They needed to eat, and they needed to sleep, and they needed a place to live, and they needed clothing, and somebody had to do that. Who would it be? Well, so the younger gods were given the jobs to support the older gods, and da-da-da-da-da, and all of that. But then somebody got the great idea, hey, we can create slave labor. We can create people. And those people will take care of us because we are great and powerful. And these people will take care of us and meet our needs. They'll feed us sacrifices. They'll house us temples. And so this was all part of a system of thinking where people meet the needs of the gods. In turn, of course, the gods had to meet the needs of the people, because if the gods didn't send rain, the people couldn't grow food and the gods wouldn't be fed. If the people were always subject to invasion and warfare and plague and disease, people would die and they wouldn't take care of the gods. So the people needed to take care of the gods, and so the gods needed to take care of the people. And so the whole system of thinking in the ancient world was this codependence, this mutual need. And that drove the religious systems of the ancient world. And so if you would ask a Babylonian, why did God create us? Answer was pretty clear. They needed slave labor. It's so different when God speaks in the Old Testament. He doesn't create people so they can feed him. In fact, he plants a garden to feed them. And he tells them, I own the cattle on 1,000 hills. If I were hungry, I wouldn't ask you. David says, I want to build you a grand house, a palace. God says, don't need it. Never ask for it. This is so counterintuitive in the ancient world. A God without needs, driven by something else. Driven not just to make everything wonderful for the God, but driven by a desire to dwell among the people that he created, and to be in relationship with them. Not a relationship of need. So that's how the Bible gets started. We miss a lot of it because we don't know the sharp contrast in the ancient world. So it starts out then with God ordering, organizing the cosmos under his control, like a new CEO coming into a company, like a new pastor coming into a church, kind of reorganization so that it's all the way that he wants it to run. And then he dwells among them. And that's what we face in the Garden of Eden, chapter 2. God dwelling with the people that he has placed there. Because that's why God did it. And so in chapter 2, we find people put in the garden that God has provided for them and dwelling among them in relationship. Everything looks like it's going well. Yeah, for two chapters. then we hit chapter 3 and things go on the skids. By now you're worried. If we're going to go all the way to Revelation, okay, I hope you brought a lunch. No, anyway. So we get to chapter 3. What happens in chapter 3? Oh, we talk about sin and disobedience, eating fruit, and fine. But that's not the big deal. What is it that they ate that fruit, that it stood for, that it represented, that it meant? It is a fruit of wisdom, knowledge of good and evil. Now, here's how the setup was. God created people in his image. What does that mean? He created them in his image, and then it tells us what he means by that. Not, and you'll look just like me. Oh, you have my eyes. You know, no, not that. Okay? Not, oh, you're the same shape as me. No. Chapter 1, he created them in his image, and then it says what they're supposed to do. Subdue and rule. They are order bringers. God's creation was order bringing. And now he has created them because he's not done yet. He's not done yet bringing order. And he has brought people into place because they are going to be his vice regents, his stewards, his associates. They get to work alongside him to bring order, his order. They're in his image. He's an order bringer. They're order bringers. Subdue and rule, bringing his order to the world. We know that the world was not fully ordered because, you know, there's an outside the garden where it ain't nice. So people are supposed to be working alongside God to bring his order in the world. You know, in employment situations, they call it ownership. You know, you want to get on board? You want to be with the program? Working all together to carry out the vision? We do that in church, too. And so, people have this task. Chapter 3, when they take that fruit, they're not just taking a piece of pulp. They're taking wisdom. And they do so in order to embark on their own journey for bringing order. Not God's order now. Their order. Want to do it my way? I've got a better idea. We're going to bring order for our benefit instead of God's benefit. We're going to do it our way. And of course, God says, not in my backyard. You want to bring order? You think you can do this? You think you're up to it on your own? Really? Go ahead. And so they lose access to God's presence, driven out of the garden. They lose relationship, driven out of the garden. They take their own path and decide that they are going to do order their way. And as you move through those early chapters of Genesis, we kind of see how that goes. It ain't pretty. Cain and Abel, the flood, right? We move through and we see it's not working so well. So, for instance, it takes us to the Tower of Babel, Genesis chapter 11. Now, here's another place where we kind of miss what's going on because we don't know the ancient world. It's very easy to kind of read and say, oh, these people were arrogant, they were proud, and they wanted to climb up to heaven and do something nasty. replace God or be alongside of God or who knows what, be gods themselves. But we know that in the ancient world, that's not what's going on. This is a ziggurat, this tower, and we know them well in the ancient world now. That hasn't been for that long that we've known, but we know them well in the ancient world. And we know what they're for. They're part of sacred space. They're built next to the temple. And as they build way up into the sky, they are building it not so that they can go up, here's key, but so that God can come down. That's what those towers are for. They're built next to temples as an invitation. Here, we've provided you with the convenience, and you can just come on down, walk into your temple, and we'll worship you. And you say, well, that doesn't sound so bad. But remember what I told you about what they think worship is. Worship is meeting the needs of the gods. So the ziggurats were the invitation for God to come down, for God to enter into his temple so that they could provide his needs. This lovely house that we've made for you, this sumptuous food, these glorious clothes that we put on the idol that we've made of you. We will pamper you in every way. Y'all come down. We will pamper you in every way. And then, as a result of that, you know how the system works now, right? As a result of that, you will take care of us. We got your back. We'll take care of you. And then you'll take care of us. And when you take care of us, when we have a God in our pocket, when we have a God who's beholden to us, when we have a God who owes us, we're going to make a name for ourselves. See, in the ancient world, making a name was not just a matter of an act of pride. Everybody wanted to make a name for themselves. You could argue that today as well. In the ancient world, making a name for yourself was doing something that you would be remembered for. You could do it by great deeds. You could do it by exploits. You could do it by building projects. You can do it by being a great leader. Most people who wanted to make a name didn't want to make a name as a great villain. Ivan the Terrible. That's not the kind of name they wanted. And anybody could make a name. How did most people make a name in the world? By having children. Because who's going to remember you when you're gone? Your children, grandchildren. So making a name wasn't an act of pride. But these builders, they wanted to make a name for themselves by their arrangement with a god. And that's not a matter of pride. That's a matter of greed. They wanted to be prosperous, flourishing in every way. People protected by a god who they were taking care of. You remember the story. It's only 9 short verses in Genesis 11, but God comes down. That's exactly what they built it for. God comes down, looks around, assesses the situation, and says, it doesn't have this here in the Bible, but I can provide it, not a chance. And back up he goes. See, they are trying to establish a relationship with God, but based on mutual need, and establish God's presence. He's going to live here among us. Sounds like it should be good. Sounds good, but it isn't. Because this is still all to benefit their sense of order. They're still trying to do it their way for their benefits. How many of us kind of use our religion and faith and things to do that. We won't go into it. Something to think about. So there you are. If you're going through Genesis 1 through 11, we're in a fix. People are trying to get God's presence back, not working. People trying to establish a relationship on the wrong basis, not working. What God had always wanted, to dwell among his people in relationship with them, is not happening. The people's initiative in chapter 11 was a failed initiative. And so we turn the page into chapter 12, and we find, to our great relief as readers, God's counter-initiative. God's initiative for how he is going to be in relationship with people and dwell among them. And that counter-initiative is one that you know. It's called the covenant. In the covenant, God says that I am going to make a relationship, Abraham, with you and your family that comes after you. I'm going to be in relationship with you. And I'm going to do my ordering work through you. And so through you, all the nations of the earth will be blessed. Because I'm going to reestablish my presence through you. I'm going to reestablish my relationship with the people whom I created through you and your family. The covenant is God's initiative to reestablish relationship and presence on earth. Because that is what God has always wanted. And so we read in Leviticus as a statement of the covenant. Maybe you haven't gotten into Leviticus lately, although you went through it. But I will put my dwelling place, see it? This is the covenant. I will put my dwelling place among you, and I will not abhor you. I will walk among you and be your God, and you will be my people. Do you see it? Presence, relationship. This is what the covenant was set up to do as it pursues God's pursuit of what he has always wanted. And the covenant then drives us to the tabernacle. When the Israelites sit at the foot of Mount Sinai, it's not just so they can hear God speak and so they can receive the Torah. We often call it law. That's a misnomer. It's more wisdom than legislation. But I'm not going to get into that this morning. It's to help them to see how God's order, I've used that word a number of times, should be implemented among the people among whom he is dwelling. So the Torah is not the main deal at Sinai. The book of Exodus, first 15 chapters, the Exodus, getting out of Egypt. Then a few chapters, Torah at Mount Sinai. And then the whole last half of the book. You know, the part you go, all the details for what? The tabernacle, where God's presence will be. See, that's what happens at Sinai. God reestablishing his presence. Chapter 40 of Exodus, they're finally done building this whole thing. All those details in those last chapter after chapter. And what happens? God, he descends and takes up his dwelling place among them. You know, forget the thunder from the mountain. This is God here. It's a pretty big moment. Renewing a situation that they hadn't seen since the Garden of Eden. God dwelling among his people. Because that is what he created us for. And that is what he has always, always wanted. And so we move on. After the tabernacle, of course, comes the temple. Now we're flying, right? Then comes the temple. Same idea. And of course, we can see this in Solomon's dedicatory prayer. I won't read through that whole thing now, but notice I've got some things in bold. First line, he has given rest to his people Israel, because when God rests among them, then they have rest. Rest is not disengagement. Rest is stability, security, order. And God gives them rest from their enemies. And then you can see in the prayer, may the Lord our God be with us. You're starting to catch a drift of why I'm calling this Emmanuel theology. See, Emmanuel is one of the few Hebrew words that you all know. Emmanuel, God with us. It's not just a Christmas story, folks. Emmanuel is God's story. It's God's plan and purpose to be with us. And it means that even before Jesus picks up the name. We'll get to that in a minute. So here we are. We move through and we have this temple prayer dedicating this place where God will dwell among his people and be in relationship with them through the covenant. Covenant leads to temple. Covenant leads to temple. Covenant relationship, temple presence. Don't lose the connection. Time goes on. And we find that even though God is dwelling among his people, there's still a lot of mess and fuss. There's still things that aren't going right. The Israelites can't stop thinking about this idea that they're supposed to provide God's needs and then he'll take care of them. See, they're still trapped in their ancient world thinking. I call that system, because you know I'm an academic, so I give fancy words to things, the great symbiosis, that symbiotic relationship of mutual need. And the Israelites are still trapped in the great symbiosis. That's why they have to keep being reminded that God doesn't owe them anything. And that they're not just trampling his courts, throwing food at him, for crying out loud. Shut down that sacrificial system if that's what you're going to think of it. Why are you trampling my courts? Get out of here. You're missing the point. That's Isaiah, Jeremiah, things like that. And of course, then the time comes when, as we move through your diagram, you get to the Babylonian threat. Ezekiel, already in exile, talks about something very significant. It's in his incredible vision in chapter 10, where he sees a vision of God's presence leaving. God's presence leaving the temple. Devastating. Because that's what the temple was for. If God's not there, it's an empty, useless, meaningless building. No matter what great materials it's made of. And so we find this idea that God has left. Yet even that same prophet Ezekiel holds out some hope. Then they will know that I, the Lord their God, am with them, and that they, the Israelites, are my people. And so the restoration looks forward to them finally getting their heads on straight, of thinking about God's order represented in the covenant, not their own order, the way they bring it. And so God anticipates this time. Now, of course, Isaiah had already anticipated that as he spoke about the child, Emmanuel. And so again, we see this idea that I am with them. This is the Emmanuel theology. So it gives them something to look forward to. But of course, God does leave the temple, and the temple is destroyed, and the people are in exile. And a long time goes by. But we're going to move to the New Testament now and see this quantum leap forward. Look again at John 1:14, a verse that many of you are familiar with. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. Does that ring a new bell now? Made his dwelling among us, and we have seen his glory. The glory of the one and only Son who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. Remember, God's presence in the tabernacle and temple was accompanied by his glory. And now we find that that glory is reflected here. Now God with us in a totally new and unexpected way. The incarnation. God with us in the flesh. God not just among us, but with us, bodily, in Jesus. This helps us understand, folks, that we cannot reduce Jesus' coming to just that he was going to die for us and save us from our sins and raise from the dead. That's all important, and we don't want to miss that. But Jesus didn't just come to die. He came to be with us, to live among us, to be one of us. And if we miss that, we miss something very important about the incarnation. Now, of course, we'll fast forward through Jesus' ministry, a lot of interesting things going on there. But as we get to his last days, excuse me, remember in the upper room, we're in John 14 now, in the upper room, Jesus says to his disciples, good news, bad news. Bad news is, I'm leaving. I'm going away. And they're horrified. Oh, what are we going to do? Don't do that. Why are you doing this? He says, there's the good news. I'm going to prepare a place for you. But don't miss the next line. So that where I am, you may also be. With us. The Emmanuel isn't going to stop when Christ ascends. He's preparing a place where everyone's together, presence and relationship. And even the last words he utters as he ascends into heaven. I mean, we often focus on the Great Commission, and well, we should. Okay, go into all the world, make disciples, da da da. But what's the last line? And behold, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. That very last thing that he emphasizes, the Emmanuel theology. And he's also said, you know, I'm going to send you a comforter. And I can just picture Peter nudging Andrew and said, what's that, like a quilt or something? I don't get it. Is it going to come Amazon? What's up? They didn't know what it was. They didn't know what he was talking about. Comforter, huh? As usual, we haven't a clue. Maybe we'll figure it out sometime. But of course, that drives us to Acts 2 and to the upper room at Pentecost to see the next quantum leap. Because the next quantum leap is that not only has it all moved away from God dwelling among us and the incarnate Christ dwelling with us, but now the Holy Spirit dwelling within us. Talk about taking God's presence to the next level. And so we read about it in Acts chapter 2. And we find that the Spirit of God descends, resides, empowers, indwells. And we see that this is all the next step in Acts 2, 38 and 39. Repent and be baptized, Peter says, every one of you in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. And you'll receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. The promise Think back to covenant. The promise is for you. God now in relationship with you and dwelling among you. Of course, Pentecost isn't the end, but on the basis of this, we find that Paul can make some very important statements as he indicates that we are the temple. See the power of that right now. The temple, the place where God is dwelling with his people. We are the temple. Now just not a temple among us, but we are the temple because God dwells in us. And that's what temples were. And notice what he quotes. We've read this over and over. I will live with them and walk among them, and I will be their God, and they will be my people. Presence and relationship. We need to move along. So let's jump right to Revelation 21. What's new creation look like? How does it describe it in the revelation of John? Here, right off the bat, I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, look, God's, would you expect anything else by now? God's dwelling place is now among his people, and he will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be with them. Do you see it, folks? Relationship. Presence. This is why God created us. This is what the Bible is all about. This is what God has always wanted. So what are we supposed to do with it? Okay, this is all cool. I kind of see the thread kind of moving all the way through here. Very important. But what's that mean to me? Well, we sang about it earlier. The breath I breathe, my daily bread, desperate without him. That was a good expression of kind of how we should feel. There was a monk called Brother Lawrence, hundreds of years ago. He lived in a monastery and had decided that somehow the matins and, the various worship times they had kind of set during the day just wasn't enough. He felt that he needed to feel more of God's presence. And some of you perhaps have run into the book. It's called Practicing the Presence of God. And Brother Lawrence launched a strategy. His strategy was that maybe every hour, as the bell tolled, on the tower, every hour, he would just for a moment, whatever he was doing, he would keep doing what he was doing, but he would turn his thoughts to the idea that God is with me, and I'm with him. And whatever I'm doing, we're doing it together. And that was cool, that worked. It kind of raised his awareness. And they said, but once an hour is not enough. So he started doing it once a half hour. And then every 15 minutes. And then every 10 minutes. Until he had developed the discipline that he was constantly aware of being in the presence of God. Of God being with him. Where his life, moment by moment, was, hello, God. Kind of moment. It's interesting, sometimes we pray in a church service like this, Lord, come and be among us. But then we sing and pray and act as if he isn't necessarily, or as if he's up there. Practicing the presence of God. It's a discipline, it's a lifestyle. And that's something that we should be doing to think about what does it mean for God to be present with us. Let me end with a story. A number of years back, I was invited to a very small conference, invitation only, and I kind of wondered, how did I get invited to this? I'm just wondering how I got on their invite list. But I went and was interested to see what was going on. And as I went into the room, maybe 30, 40 people, and I started spotting name tags. Ooh. Wow. Oh, that person's here? What am I doing here? Now, since I'm standing up speaking in front of you, you might not infer this, but I'm an introvert. And that means in social situations like that, I find the wall, you know, and preferably a corner, and just kind of stand there and watch. So I'm watching, and then I saw across the room, oh, that person's here? I mean, I so admire that person and all the things. Wow, boy, it would be great if I could meet him. Wow. How could I do that? I know, I'll just kind of walk across the room and, oh, hi, do I know you? And I'm John and, no, I can't do it again. Oh, maybe if he's in a circle there, I'll just kind of join the circle and see if I can kind of get into the, no, I can't do it. Well, then they put us in small groups for a discussion, and there are maybe, you know, 12, 15 in a small group, and this person was in my small group. We were at chairs in a circle, and he was sitting right across from me, and I was, you know, I can't tell you what went on in that discussion. I was just, and I'm still thinking, I know, so when it ends, I'll just kind of, oh, kind of walk over casually, and oh, hi, and I'll introduce, no. So I'm still thinking about all of that, and the session ends, and next thing I know, this guy just comes bounding across the room. No other way to describe it. Bounding across the room, grabs my hand and starts wringing it and shaking it and saying, you know, I'm so glad you're here. I've so wanted to meet you, and I'm interested in getting to know more about you. Can we carve out some time and have a talk? And I said, well, I'm pretty busy. You know, maybe your people can get in touch with my people. And no, I don't even have people. Instead, I was thinking, boy, if he ever lets go of my hand, I'm not going to wash it ever again. Okay, let's face it. I was starstruck. To imagine that this person, who is one of my heroes, not only that I'd get to meet him, but that he seemed really, really interested in getting to know me. How unimaginable that was. You can see where I'm going, folks. I was starstruck. Maybe we need to be a bit more sunstruck. Because the fact is, the Creator God of the universe has come bounding across this cosmos, not just to shake our hands, but to embrace us as children. To say, I want to be with you. I want to spend time with you. Can we carve out some time? And too often, we're kind of like, well, have your people get in touch with my people. What is the Bible all about? It's about God's quest to be in relationship with us and to be with us. And he has gone to great lengths to make that happen. Why did God create us? Precisely for that reason. To be with us. Because it's what God has always wanted. Let's pray. Lord, we're a grateful people, not grateful enough sometimes. We're grateful that you've loved us, grateful that you've sought us out, grateful that you made us. And that you want to be with us. Help us to not lose sight of how important that is. Help us to practice your presence day by day. Help us desire to look, live, and love more like Jesus, who you sent to lead the way. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let us respond to God's word by standing together and lifting up our voices in songs of praise.
Thou forever wilt be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Summer and winter, springtime and harvest, sun, moon, and stars in their courses above, joined with all nature in manifold witness to thy great faithfulness, mercy, and love. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Pardon for sin and a peace that endureth. Thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide. Strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine with 10,000 beside. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord unto me. Is coming soon. Call back the sin, wake up the saint. Let every nation shout of your fame. Jesus is coming soon. Like a bride for her groom, will be a church ready for you. Every heart longing for our King so come, Lord Jesus, come. Even so come, Lord Jesus, come. There will be justice, all will be new. Your name forever, faithful and true. Jesus is coming soon. Like a bride waiting for her groom, we'll be a church ready for you. Every heart longing for our King, we sing, even so. Jesus, come. Even so, come, Lord Jesus, come. So we wait for you. God, we wait, you're coming. So we wait for you. God, we wait, you're coming soon. Like a bride waiting for her groom, we'll be a church ready for you. Every heart longing for our King, we see. Like a bride waiting for her groom, we'll be a church ready for you. Every heart longing for our King, we see. Even so, Jesus, come. Even so, come, Lord Jesus, come. Like a bride waiting for her groom, we'll be a church ready for you. Every heart longing for, Jesus, come. Even so, come, Lord Jesus, come. Even so, come, Lord Jesus,
as you practice the presence of God this week, as you're practicing that presence, trying to remind yourself of how God responds to you, don't let that image get out of your head of like the creator of the cosmos bounding across, coming for you. I know if you're like me, you think, not me, not, you know, not our church, not us. And yet that's how God feels about us. That's what God does to us. That is the gospel of the Bible. So I pray that encourages you as you reach out to your friends this week, as we prepare for our Sunday service next week outside. I'll be preaching on why would I believe in the Bible. We're going to spend a few weeks, and so if you've got friends who are skeptical, that you're going to want to come and check that out, and we'll do some exploration of why would I believe this wonderful story. So that's what we'll be doing next week. But God be with you. I just want you to hear this word from the book of Hebrews, which says, let us then approach the throne of grace with, what's that word? Confidence. Knowing that you have got all the grace and mercy that you need in Jesus. And all God's people said, Amen. We've got some wonderful snacks for you out there if you'd like to eat some of those. We're going to have a conversation.